Hello and welcome to CS303. Today we are going to be starting a new chapter, chapter number 3. Okay. So this chapter is titled Processes. So we can, if you just think back, what did we cover in the first two chapters? Chapter 1 was an introduction and it talked about what an OS is. Right, what are some of the roles for an operating system. It talked about a brief overview of computer organization, computer architecture concepts, and then it talked about various kinds of computing systems in terms of the operating system needed for those, right? So there an OS for a mobile phone versus an OS for a watch and so on. Right. Chapter 2 talked about user interfaces, how one can interact with the operating system. It talked about system calls, right? It talked about various ways in which we can structure an OS, right? And then finally, various tools available for performance monitoring, debugging, and so on. Okay. So now, actually, we move on to deeply analyzing various components of an OS. Okay. So first two chapters were mostly an overview. Now we are actually going to dive deep into the OS components, OS goals. So while doing that, first area we will discuss is process management. So a process, it's essentially a program in execution, and while running, a process will need certain resources. So here I'm just reading from the book, the introduction. A process will need certain resources such as CPU time, memory, files, and IO devices to accomplish its task. These resources are typically allocated to the process at runtime while it is executing. Okay. So systems consist of a collection of processes, operating system processes executing system code and user processes executing user code, right? And these processes may execute concurrently because we have many CPUs available. So these processes may execute concurrently at the same time. Okay. So modern operating systems support processes having multiple threads of control. So in chapter number 4, we will talk about the concept in which we can have one process, one program, but many threads of control in it, sort of parallel sequence of instructions being executed. On systems with multiple hardware processing CPUs, of course, these threads can run in parallel. One of the most important aspects of an OS is how it schedules threads onto the available processing units. So scheduling is important, we'll be looking into that. And several choices for designing CPU schedulers are available to programmers. Some target speed, some target meeting deadlines, some target fairness, and so on. So as such, the coming chapters are all about process management. Okay. So process can also be looked at as a program. It can also be looked at as an application. And we know that an OS manages the execution of processes. So all of the tasks that it does while managing their execution, they all come under process management. So we start with chapter number 3, lecture 1. Okay, now I am on slide number 2. And these are the topics that we will discuss in chapter number 3. Okay. So first, process concept, right? So here we will discuss what exactly is a process. We'll find out a lot more about it, right? How it can be implemented. So in this chapter, we'll actually start discussing how we can implement system calls. So we'll be doing system programming. Second topic is process scheduling. So we will have an introduction to that. So given us set of processes, given a set of CPUs, how do I schedule the processes to execute on the CPUs? How do I share the CPUs among several processes? And which process goes first, which goes second? For how long is the process run? Those kind of issues will crop up in process scheduling. So we'll talk about it. In this chapter, we'll only have an introduction to process scheduling. More details will be discussed in chapter number 5. Some operations which are allowed on processes, so things like creating a process, terminating a process, taking a piece of code and just sort of copying and pasting it on top of a process so that the process executes that piece of code. So all of these are essentially system calls. So we will learn about a bunch of system calls which specify operations which we can do on processes. Finally, we will discuss IPC, which is inter-process communication. So from time to time, processes may need to communicate with each other. So consider a picture you're uploading on Facebook. So that's one process, client process, and then it has to be uploaded on Facebook server. That is a server process. So again, there has to be some communication. You have to generate a request, and then that request needs to be accepted by the server, and then you transport your picture, and then finally it is registered in the server, which accepts it. So we need some mechanism for communication among processes. So this important term is called inter-process communication or IPC. So these are the four things we will discuss in chapter 3: process concept, process scheduling, process operations, and inter-process communication. Now I am on slide 3. So this whole course has bunch of objectives, and likewise each chapter also has some objectives. So what are the objectives for chapter 3? What is the knowledge that you can hope to have once we finish this chapter? So one is, first objective is to introduce the notion of a process, which is a program in execution, which forms the basis of all computation. So one of the most important goals of an operating system is to provide an environment in which, applications can run on the hardware, right? Programs can execute. So key to this is, notion of a program or a process. So there is some subtle difference between the two. So if a process is actually running, which means its instructions are being executed, then it becomes a program. So to learn more about processes, which are programs in execution, and to describe the various features of processes, and they include scheduling, creation and termination, communication. So we will have we will discuss system calls for each one of these. So when I want to create a process, how can I do that? What system call do I call? If I want two processes to communicate with each other, what is the set of system calls that I need to use, right? So for all these process operations, we have specific system calls. So we will be writing C programs which perform the operations using these system calls. So these two are the objectives: to discuss processes and do some programming which using system calls illustrates various operations which can be performed on processes. Okay, so now I am on slide number 4, right? And it's titled Introduction. So process is one of the most critical central concepts in the study of operating systems. We saw in chapter 1, one of the goals of an OS is to regulate program execution. So it's sort of a regulator, sort of a manager. So, among all the processes that are executing, so we must understand that the hardware resources are limited. So in case a very large number of programs want to run, we have to do some regulation so that we are fair to all the programs and our overall system behavior is good. So OS is a piece of code which regulates program execution. So process is a program in execution, right? So initially, you know, if you have your PowerPoint or your Microsoft Word, which is sitting, a copy of which is sitting on the disk, you can say it's a process. Now, as soon as you double click it, then you know that the whole program, the Word or PowerPoint or Excel, the whole program or part of the program, initial part of the program maybe, is brought from where to where? Brought from disk to main memory. And the intention of bringing the program into the main memory is, you would know, is to execute it. So now, for that application, if the instructions are being executed by the CPU, right? So, you know, whatever those instructions are, maybe accepting input in a Word file from the keyboard, maybe printing a document, right? Maybe drawing a table, you know, whatever. So whatever those instructions are, you know, for that program, they are executing. So while instructions are executing, process becomes a program. And we, of course, we know to execute, it will need access to certain resources. What are those? Already know the answer to that. CPU time, definitely, right? It is ultimately the CPU which is executing the instructions. Needs access to memory, various kinds of memory. Main memory, registers, cache, so on. Needs access to files, right? Of course, file system, I/O devices, keyboard, monitor, and so on. So, these are the resources that the process needs. And who allocates and regulates the usage of these resources? As you can guess, it's the operating system. So we also say a process is a unit of work in operating systems. So one way of measuring OS behavior is how good is the OS in terms of executing processes. So which means for a unit amount of time, let's say for, you know, it could be 1 minute, 5 minutes, 10 minutes, on an average, what is the progress a process is making? So, of course, you would want that number to be high, right? Because a low number means less progress. So, which means the OS algorithms have to be such that the amount of work done is maximized. So, later on, we'll see how, those algorithms are created, how they work. So, we have two kinds of processes, user processes, for example, your web browser. And system processes, for example, your CPU scheduler or your memory manager. Okay, now I am on slide 5. Our title is Introduction Continued. So we just mentioned in the previous slide that a process is a program in execution, which means execution means its instructions are being executed. So we can evaluate the effectiveness, goodness of an OS by observing how many processes it can execute per unit time, throughput. So which we just talked about. High number is desirable. Okay. If you go back a bit, let's say 60s, 70s, early operating systems allowed only one program to be executed at a time. So if you would recall from chapter 2, the structure of DOS, Microsoft's DOS disk operating system. So the way it worked was it allowed only one process to be executed at a time. In fact, first it loads in the kernel and then you pick a process and then again kernel, then another process and so on. So at any point of time, only one process is executed. Okay. And that program had complete access to all resources. So the OS design was, of course, that way quite simple. There was no sharing, no multiplexing of resources, hardware resources among the processes or the programs. Whichever program is running, it has access to all system resources. So with better hardware, systems can now support multiple programs to be loaded into memory and executed concurrently. So this is that multi-programming concept that we discussed. So now you have multiple programs you can bring into memory, and you can juggle the execution of among all of them. So if a process is doing I/O, you can give the CPU to another process and it can execute. So to get a snapshot of how your various system resources are being used, there are several tools available. So no matter what your operating system is, there's a tool for that. If you are looking at Windows, the tool is Task Manager. If you are looking at a Mac, the tool is Activity Monitor. If you're looking at Linux, the tool is there's a System Monitor. But rather than that, I would actually, you can see that, that's fine. But I would recommend TOP, T-O-P, Table of Processes. So for Mac, Activity Monitor, for Windows, Task Manager, for Linux, System Monitor, or you type in the command TOP, Table of Processes. So this will give you a sort of a snapshot of, you know, how the processes are being executed, how they are, you know, using the resources. Okay. So in one of the live sessions, we'll be looking more at it. But if I just go ahead and open, my activity monitor, or my, if I run the TOP program on Linux, so it tells me, you know, it shows me all the processes with their names. So if I see I've got a Chrome process running, the TOP itself is a program which is running. I have got, some system processes running. I've got a Gnome shell running. So shell is our command line interface. And I've got a whole bunch of processes. So each of these processes, you can search for them and you can find out more about what they do. So some of them are system processes, some are user processes. So in Linux, when I type TOP, under the user column, you will see either my username or your username, or you will see root. So root ones are system, and then username is, of course, user processes. So Chrome is a user process. Gnome shell is a user process, so on. Other kind of processes are system processes. So there's a CPU process. There's a migration process, there's a watchdog process, so on. Okay. So I would encourage you to look at these tools, and then in one of the live sessions, we'll also, talk a bit about them. So this tells you how, your resources are being utilized. Right. So it tells me I've got 315 processes or tasks, as Linux calls them. Two of them are running, 260 are sleeping. So these are process states, which we'll soon cover. Zero is stopped, zero is zombie. Percentage of CPU is telling me what is my CPU percentage, right? So 2.49 for system, 4.08 for user. It's telling me how my memory is being used, right? My percentage of memory usage, 20%, 30%. It's telling me how my disk is being used, right? How many reads I've done on the disk, how many writes I've done on that disk. So this gives us a pretty good idea of, a snapshot of the system, what processes are running, more information about the processes, what has been their consumption, how much CPU they've consumed, how much memory they've consumed, what is the process name, what is the process ID, since when has the process been running. So it will be useful to check out these tools. Okay, now I am on slide number 6. Where we talk about the PROC directory in Linux, /proc. So on your Linux terminal, if you type cd/proc, you can get to that, PROC directory. So it would be, in fact, it is required that all of you have a Linux machine. So if you have, whatever kind of laptop you have, you should install Linux on it. So you can either install Linux natively by doing a dual boot, right? or you can install or you can use Linux using a virtual machine. So you install VirtualBox, and then within that VirtualBox you download Linux. So then your Linux runs as an application within your Windows or Apple machine. So these are two options. We'll share more details. You can also look online, but you should have a Linux machine, available with you, because most of the programming, you know, it will be using system calls, and those are POSIX, system calls. So you need access to Linux machine for that. So either you can do a dual boot, install it natively on the hardware, or you can use it using VirtualBox. So on your Linux terminal, if you type cd / proc, it takes us to that process directory. So directory of all processes. So each process itself is a directory named after its process ID. So if you do an ls for listing the contents of a directory, it's a program. So you'll see a bunch of, numbers. So, depending on the process we are talking about, each has its own directory. And these numbers that you see, these are the process IDs. So we'll soon, look into that. So what you can do is you can try to go into any one of them. So if I say CD 1208, you can pick any one, right? And then you can do an ls. And again, bunch of files and directories and executables show up. Okay. So among that, status will be one. So you can see contents of status. For that, you can use a vi editor. So type vi status, right? So it will give you a bunch of information. Name of the process. It's called IBUS X11. Looks like a system process. State is sleeping, right? So it was turned on at some point of time. Now its instructions are not being executed, so it has just gone to sleep. It can be woken up. Process ID is 1208. Parent process ID is 1, so which is likely the root. And virtual, how much memory it has consumed, right? These kind of different kinds of information. CPUs allowed 0 to 5, right? How many context switches? So when a process is running and you want to give the CPU to another process, you do a context switch. So that kind of information. So we can find out a lot more about it. Or you can say vi schedule, SCHED. So it tells us about the, it has 7 threads, right? IBUS process, its runtime, start time, number of context switches, clock data, and so on. So essentially you can peek into the system and you can find out more about that process. So it would be a good idea to on your Linux terminal, go to the process directory and try to peek in many processes and find out more about them, right? What's their process ID? What is the user ID? What is their state? What are their memory sizes? How many threads do they have? What are their start times, execution times, and so on? So it would be a really good exercise. Okay. So now when I search for this process, it's IBUS. It's an intelligent input bus for Linux or Unix. Okay. It provides full-featured, user-friendly input method, user interface. So again, we don't need to know too much detail about it, just what it is and what it does. So it has to do with input management. So like that, you are encouraged to, look at various other processes within Linux. Okay, now I am on slide number 7, title process concept. Okay. So just to clarify some nomenclature, textbooks will use the terms job and process interchangeably, which means that they will use them in place of each other. Okay. So as such, whenever you read a job and a process, so they will eventually mean the same thing. So we are also going to be doing that. Now, one major question is, what does a process contain, right? So it's a piece of code, which means that it has its own address space, you know, within the main memory. So when we're talking about a particular process, what does that process contain? Can we divide that process into certain components, certain parts for better understanding? So it turns out, yes, the process does contain multiple parts. We'll see a picture on the next slide. This is also available on the book. So you will see that what are the various parts, right? So one part of the process, as you can guess, would definitely be the program code. So essentially, it's a piece of code. It's got some instructions which need to be executed on the hardware. So one part of the process contains the process code or the program code, right? Because once it is in a running state, we call it a program now. So this is generally, this part is called, or this section is called, the text section, okay? And as you can guess, it is an executable file, right? So a .exe in Windows, for example, right? This includes current activity of the process execution wise. For example, what's the program value of the program counter? So we do know what does a program counter do. So it contains the memory address of the next instruction to be executed, right? Memory address of the next instruction to be executed. Contents of processor registers, CPU registers, right? So let's say if you're adding two numbers, right, and the result, right? So all of this, code and related data is stored in the text section. That's one part. Another section is your stack. So generally the text section is fixed. The only way the text section can change is if the owner of that process, of that application, releases an update, right? An update may increase the code or it may reduce the code. So maybe if they made the memory management algorithm more efficient, maybe it reduces the code. If they added more features to some functionality, maybe they the code has increased, right? So, but as such, the size of the text section will be static. Stack, now the size of the stack will grow. So we know how a stack grows from the top. So in a stack, both the additions and deletions happen from the top. Bottom is sealed. So what is the use of the stack component? The stack is used for storing temporary data, right? So what are some examples of temporary data? Function call and parameters, right? So function calls and the parameters, you call those functions with the arguments, return addresses for functions, local variables, right? So again, these are all temporary. And once the process exits or finishes execution, these variables are gotten rid of or removed, right? So all of this temporary data is contained in the stack. And note that the stack can grow. So as you're calling more and more functions, right, you don't know at runtime what functions you'll be calling. It depends on what option the user picks, right? So as you'll be calling more and more functions, the size of the stack will grow. So it contains function call, function parameters. Functions will always have a return address, in organization architecture. And you will have local variables. So any kind of temporary data that you have will be stored in the stack, grows dynamically. Another is your data section. So this contains other kind of data which is not temporary. For example, global variables which are being shared across multiple processes, right? So those kind of variables will be in the data section. Okay. So you have one section for the code, the text, you have another section for data. In fact, you have two sections, data section and stack section. The other component of a process is the heap data structure. Hopefully you would have studied that in the data structure class. So this heap, it contains memory that is dynamically allocated. So one way it can be allocated is using malloc. So malloc is a system call. It's a function used to allocate memory, right? In data structures, you may have used this. If I have a linked list and I want to reserve memory for 5 nodes, so then I have to call malloc and ask the system to reserve memory required for 5 nodes. So it will be a structure variable. Depending on what it contains, a pointer to the next node, some value, and accordingly the calculations are made for how much memory is required. Malloc allocates it, and then what does it return? Malloc will return a pointer to the beginning of that memory location. So any memory dynamically located will come from the heap. So which means your heap will also grow. So because you don't know the size of the data structure, your linked list, for example, so it is dynamic. So as such, you know, these are the different parts of components of a process. Okay, so now I am on slide number 8, parts of a process in main memory. Okay, so this is an executing program, and you can see at the bottom here the text section which contains your code. Then you have the data section, which has, let's say, global variables. Then you have the dynamically increasing stack and heap, right? Stack for temporary data, right? And heap for dynamically allocated memory. So these are the parts of a process. So whenever process is brought in from, say, disk to main memory, then it is assigned a certain amount of main memory. And that memory becomes the process's address space. So each process has an address space. So you know, whatever this is, from 0 to max, this is the address space of a particular process. Okay, now I am on slide number 9, memory layout of a C program. So in the previous slide number 8, we saw in general the memory layout for a certain process. Now we look at it in a bit more detail in terms of a C program. C program is a process, and here you can see what this program is doing. Quite a simple one. It is allocating some memory. How much memory? So memory capable of size of int, which is generally, so it's 4 bytes into 5, so looks like an array of 5 integers. So 4 into 5, 20 bytes, reserve 20 bytes, and then the starting memory location of that block of 20 bytes is copied to the pointer values. Okay, and now for I is 0 to 4, values of I is I. So what are we loading that array with now? What are the contents of that array? 0, 1, 2, 3, and 4. Okay. Values is local variable, local to the this process, this program. I is also local. And there are, let's say, some global variables which for, so they are not being used, but for just for simplicity, we assume that they are global variables, and which means that they can be seen and being used, they can be used by many functions. Okay. So here now you see memory layout of the program, right? And what you will see is, if you look at stack, so stack it's supposed to contain temporary data. So here mostly you will find local variables. So which are those? Values and I. Okay, it will be stored there. They will be stored there. Heap, as we said, is for storing dynamically allocated memory, for example, using malloc. So that memory will, this chunk of 20 bytes will be, in the heap. And then you can call more mallocs, heap will grow. Right. So that is that. And the argc and argv, so you may be aware, these are the command line arguments. So we can call this when we are executing this function, we can specify arguments here. So
So those are stored in a separate space. So there are some differences versus the memory layout we saw in the previous slide. One difference is that the global data section is divided into two subsections now, one for initialized data and another for uninitialized data. Right? So initialized is, which one is initialized? It's Y, so it goes in that section. Which global data is uninitialized? It's X, goes in the other section. And also a separate section is provided for argc and argv command line parameters, which are passed to the main function. Okay, so separate section is provided. But as such, you get the gist. The text contains your code, right? Then you have a data section for generally for global variables. Then you have stack for temporary variables. And then you have heap for dynamically allocated memory. Okay. So in this way, we have a memory layout for a simple C program. I hope it's clear. Now I am on slide 10, process concept continued. So we've already discussed the difference between a program and a process. So by definition, a process is a passive entity, right? It's an executable file, definitely. It is stored on the disk, let's say. It may be stored on other kinds of memory like SSD, right? So for example, my desktop has a disk of 1 terabyte, whereas my laptop has an SSD of, I think, probably 256 megabytes. So it's a passive entity stored in disk or any other such memory, capable of a persistent or permanent storage. It will be deleted. Whereas a process is active, which means instructions are being executed. So program becomes a process when the executable file is copied and loaded from disk to memory. So how can we do that? So one option is, if you are using GUI, we just double click it, right? Or single click it, that process. So process will have an icon. We just click it, right? Or we can use a command line and enter the name of the process. Sometimes it may be dot slash, sometimes just the name of the process. So if I go to Linux, I type in ls. So ls is a process for, or a program for listing the contents of the current directory. So whether it's home or cs303 or any such, you know, directory. So you know that program can become a process either via GUI mouse click or going to the command line and entering the name of the process. Okay. Note that one program can spawn or give rise to several processes. Okay. So consider multiple users executing the same program on a multi-user machine. Right. So let's say if you have a networked lab in which you've put some compiler and many some parallel compiler, and many users are using that same process at the same time concurrently. So you have one shared program, but then it's spawning many processes which will ultimately become programs. So what will happen in terms of the contents? The text for each user will be the same. But for each user, the data stack and heap will vary. So because it's a compiler, so different users may compile different programs. Now different programs means different global variables. It means different local variables. It means different sections of the memory being allocated dynamically. So in these cases, although the text section will be the same, but the other sections will vary. They will be different. So we see separation of process code and data facilitates sharing of code. So code remains same and data varies. So in the chapter on memory management, we will look at this in more detail. So, but what we have done is we have demarcated, or we have separated out the code and the data. They're not mixed together. They're in different sections. So code is in a separate section, data is in some other sections. So this makes sharing very, very easy. each user has the same code, but they can have their own data. Right, makes sharing very easy. Yeah, so I hope this is clear, right? Okay, now I am on slide 11, and the slide is titled process state. Okay, so turns out that process can be in many states corresponding to its life cycle. Okay, so generally these states are useful in various OS operations. For example, if you want to, if you make a policy to, delete all sleeping processes, right? And in that case, you need to know for each process whether it is sleeping or not. And how do you know? By checking the value of its state property, its state attribute, right? State variable. Okay. So like that, many other operations may need to be performed. So, for example, you may want to schedule a process that has just arrived, a new process. So then again, if state is new, you send it for scheduling, right, so on. So therefore, there are many states a process can be in. And what are some of the states? New, running, waiting, ready, terminated. So these are some generic names. The actual states can vary from operating system to operating system. What is true in all of the cases is, as the process executes, it will change its state from one to the other. Right. So we'll soon see a diagram which illustrates that state change. Okay. So what are some of the states? One is new. New means the process is being created. So let's say you double click on a process, becomes a program, and now it's a new process into the system which has to be executed. So state is new. Another state is running. So what is it's not guaranteed that as soon as a process arrives into the system, it will get the CPU immediately. It may have to wait in a process queue. So there can be a queue of processes in which a new process has to wait. So if a process is currently executing, or more precisely, if the instructions of a process are currently executing, it is in running state. Yeah. Next is waiting state. A process is waiting for some event to occur. So let's say it had some CPU burst. CPU is executing instructions, and then it needs to do some IO. Maybe it's waiting for some user input. So in that case, till that user input comes, it cannot proceed executing the next instruction. So its state changes to waiting. Once the IO completes, it can change state from waiting to something else. Fourth state is ready, which means process is waiting to be assigned to a processor. So there will be a ready queue consisting of all processes that are ready to run. So for example, for a process that might have been in the waiting state, once the IO is completed, then its state may change to ready. Okay. So, once IO completes, again, there's no guarantee that the process will get the CPU. It may have to wait for a while in a queue. And then finally, we have terminated state. The process has finished execution. All instructions have been executed for that process. So if you want to see on a Linux machine what your process states are, you can use a top or htop command. So top, as we discussed, stands for table of processes. Htop stands for horizontal table of processes. So if you just click on, type top on your Linux terminal command line, you will see some statistics. So for each process, you will see a value called S. Right, so that is for state. So there are many states. For some of them, we will see S as a state value, which is short form for sleeping. Okay, so once a process schedules an I/O, then it may put itself to sleep, waiting for the event to complete, and CPU can be given to some other task. Once the I/O event completes, state can change from sleeping to something else. So you'll see a bunch of processes for which state is S, S for sleeping. Another one is R. R is for running. So incidentally, you'll see which process has R. It will be top, because top is of course running right now. Another code you will see is which you may see is T, which can be for stopped, Z, which can be for zombie, right? So zombie processes are terminated processes, you know, that are wishing to have some status information collected. So later on in this chapter, we'll see or we'll study the conditions which can cause a process to become a zombie process, right? Now, sort of like, you know, you may have seen in movies, what's a zombie? Sort of a person who's died but is not totally dead yet, right? So process follows similar approach. So processes have, zombie processes have terminated, but they're waiting to collect some status information. So not terminated yet, right? So that Z you can also see. So these will be some states, and they will vary from OS to OS. And even in Linux, they will vary from system to system. For Ubuntu, it may be different than what it is for, Klinux, or for, some other Linux version like Linux Mint. Right? So, you know, these states you can see. So one of the states I see is I, which unfortunately my code does not say, my table does not say. So I can try to search. Oh, it is probably not showing it. Runnable RDSZT. Right. So again, you can do a search and see what those states are. Okay. Yeah. So I think it probably might mean idle. I might mean idle. So I'm seeing S for sleeping, I for idle, R for running. Yeah. Maybe Z for zombie. So you can do some. You can run some code which can cause a process to be a zombie. We'll soon see. So, you know, using top or htop, you can see that. Okay. Okay, so I hope, you know, this state concept is clear now. Okay, now I am on slide 12, which shows a diagram of process states. So, as we said, during a life cycle of a process, a state can change from one to the other. So, beginning state is new, right? New process. Now again, we cannot assume that by default a new process would be admitted to the system for execution. So consider a supercomputer, high performance computing facility, in which you have to submit jobs or processes. So there, whenever you submit a job, it may have to wait in a waiting queue. And then eventually when the load is, the system load is less, it will be admitted into the system. But you know, in operating systems like the ones we use in Android or in Windows and such operating systems, this step may not be needed. That means a new process becomes a ready process straight away. So one is new, state is new. Then once a process is admitted into the system for execution, it changes state to ready. Now from ready, a couple of options are there. Or I'm sorry, from ready there is only one option. It can be running. So that's the only thing it can do. So it's ready to run. So eventually the CPU will pick it up depending on the scheduling algorithm. And once the CPU picks it up, state changes to running. So now instructions are being executed. Scheduler dispatch. Which means the process will be dispatched from the ready queue data structure CPU for execution. So dispatch by the scheduler. So while it's running now, there can be many paths. either it finishes execution, exits, and then is terminated, okay, or it needs to do some IO, waiting for some event. So if that is the case, then the state changes from running to waiting. So waiting could correspond to idle, or it could correspond to sleep on some machines. And then eventually that IO or whichever event it's waiting for completes, an interrupt is generated, and it is now ready to run again. So then it goes directly to ready queue. And eventually again, it's depending on the scheduling algorithm, it will be picked up by the CPU. Or the running process may be interrupted. So maybe it's a preemptible process. So let's say process is executing and another more important process arrives at the CPU. So now we preempt the currently running process, which means we, sort of halt or abort its execution, stop its execution, and then make it go back to the ready queue and give the CPU to the newer or more important process. So in that case, in case of an interrupt, it goes back to the ready queue. Right, so these are the states. So again, at each state, many decisions have to be made. So from new, it goes to ready. That's only state change that can happen. From ready, the only state change that can happen is running. No other is possible. State is possible. From running, we have many options. In fact, it can go back to ready. It can go back, go to waiting, or it can terminate. Then from waiting again, only one option, waiting to ready. So this is how, the state of a process can change during its course of execution, from its birth to its termination. Okay. So I hope it's clear.